Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus the Christ. Speedy Morris, I was just reading about him earlier last week. Speedy Morris was a basketball coach, mostly for high school students. He always wanted to coach in college, and finally he got his chance. He was called by LaSalle and hired by them to coach their college football team. And he was excited, as you can imagine. Not long after he received the job, he was shaving one morning, and his wife came into the bathroom and said, "Speedy," he said, "the sports illustrator wants to talk to you." And he was so excited at knowing that LaSalle was not a big college that would warrant that kind of presence and kind of question, kind of interview. And he was so excited he cut himself. And blood was running down. He took a wad of toilet paper and just held it there and was running down the stairs. And again, he was so excited he actually fell down and almost broke his foot. And then he got to the phone and he said, "Sports Illustrated?" And the voice on the other end said, "Yes, for 75 cents an issue, you can have a year subscription." Can you imagine? His glorious expectations settled down and became glorious, sort of unglorious problem. Expectations shape so much of what we do. And tonight I want to talk to you and talk with you about our expectations for what it means to be a follower of Christ. It's important for us to recognize that in the Bible we are given a very clear picture of what it means to follow Christ and what it means not to follow him. We, for example, in our country, in my opinion, do a great disservice when we tell our children, and when we have been told the same thing, when we tell our children that if they only work hard enough, they can accomplish anything. The fact is, that's a lie. Or we can tell our children, "You can always do the best," and we sort of mix that up sometime and say, not only can you do the best, but the president is proof that you could be president. And so people are misled, in my opinion, when you make those kind of statements and create those kind of expectations. Because they are worldly expectations which will never be fulfilled. Everybody cannot accomplish everything that they want. It's ridiculous for us to think that we can do it. And yet, the expectation in many of us is exactly that, especially if you look at the way we go about trying to be successful. We try to be so successful in our lives. We race after success. We race after power. We race after prestige. We race after all of those things which the world supposedly has told us are the most important things in life. But let me read to you a passage from the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And I think we can begin to see what I'm talking about. In chapter 3, 1 Corinthians, Paul writes, "Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for solid food. Indeed, you are still not ready, you are still worldly, for since there is a jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not?" This is not proof that you are worldly. You see, Paul establishes for us a clear dichotomy, a clear dualism between being led by the Spirit and being led by the flesh or by worldly points of view, worldly standards. And that's not only true in the first chapter of Corinthians. That's true all the way through the Bible. The Bible always faces us with a choice. And the choice is always between God and us. For example, the first commandment. Right out of the starting line. What does God say, the first commandment? "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." In other words, the choice is clear. Our choice is to be either for God or not for God. As Jesus said in the sixth chapter, as recorded in the sixth chapter of Matthew. Why does it say you cannot what? Serve God and mammon at the same time? It just can't be done. Well, Joshua, he is faced by the people, and he says to the people, look, I don't know about you, but I'm making a choice, and you have to make a choice as well. So in one sense, then, we have this choice before us. We are worldly Christians. But what's a worldly Christian? A worldly Christian is somebody who believes in Jesus, but follows the values of the world. Somebody who believes in Jesus, but follows the values of the world. And most of us, in one way or another, have at one time or another succumbed to the values of the world. We like prestige, we like power, we like pleasure, we like all of those things which are offered by the world, but they're also offered by the world as a way of seducing us and living a life which is based upon Satan's rather than Christ's commands. So we have this text that I just read, and we can go on and read other texts and find that God is saying basically the same thing. But what I want to do at this point is to point out some of the ways in which we are worldly, as written in the first book, first letter to John, the second chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. Do not love the world. Now we have to be clear. Jesus, through John, is not saying that the world is bad. In fact, we know that the text in John records God, Jesus saying, what? God so loved the world that he gave his only son to die for us so that we might have eternal life. I added that sentence about that he died for us. So the world is not completely something which is disputed. After all, God created it. God created the world. God created us in the world. He loves the world. But that is different than being worldly. Worldly means that we live by the standards that the worldly standards rather than by God's standards. That we continue to confess Jesus, but when you look at our lives are no different than the lives of anyone else around us. So do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, and here sort of get itemized, there it is. Everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, or as one of the Bible NIV, older NIV translation has it, the cravings of a human being. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life come not from the Father, but come from the world. So here we are. We have a choice. On one hand, we can choose the worldly way and go that way. And many of us do. And many of us do on one day and not the next day, so we have to be reminded that this is a danger that exists every day of the week, not just on particular days when we are weak. Every day of the week, we are confronted by that choice to follow the worldly standards or to follow what Christ has said in Christ's standards, and that is being led by the Spirit. So when we are led by the Spirit, when we are led by the Spirit, we can be certain that we are followers of God. But until then, we really have to watch out because it is so easy for us to succumb to the lower standards. There's a story about this older gentleman who was walking along the road and suddenly he heard a voice that says, hey, hey there, old man, hey, what's going on? And the man looked around, couldn't see anything, and he walked a little farther, and there he saw a frog. The frog was talking to him. He says, hey, old man. He says, if you kiss me, he said, I will turn into a beautiful princess and I will be with you for the rest of your life. And he picked up the frog and put it in his pocket and walked on. A little bit later, the frog said, didn't you hear me? He said, if you kiss me, I'm going to turn into a beautiful princess and will live with you for the rest of my life. And he didn't say anything. And again, frog yelled at him and said, what's the matter with you? Didn't you hear me? So he takes out his frog and looks at the frog and said, at my age, I'd rather have a talking frog. Don't settle.